Imagine standing on the surface of another world. The sky above you, thin, cold, alien, glows a pale butterscotch at midday. The horizon stretches endlessly, painted in shades of rust and amber. You're suited up, your breath recycled, your heartbeat the only sound louder than the wind. And then you see it, a wall, not of stone or ice, but of dust, miles high, moving toward you like a living thing, swallowing the landscape whole. This is Mars, and for decades we thought we understood its storms. We were wrong. Recently, NASA released new orbital data that reveals something extraordinary and unsettling. Martian dust storms don't just move across the surface. They interact with the atmosphere in ways we never predicted. Ways that blur the line between weather and chemistry. Between predictable and chaotic. And if we're serious about sending humans to Mars, if we're serious about survival, we need to understand what's really happening up there. Because the dust on Mars isn't just a nuisance. It might be one of the most dangerous forces we'll ever face. Let's go back to 2018. The Opportunity rover, a machine that had survived 14 years on Mars, went bowment. Not because it broke down, not because it ran out of power in the traditional sense, it was killed by dust. A planet-wide storm engulfed Mars that summer. For months, the sun disappeared. Solar panels were smothered. Temperatures plummeted. And when the skies finally cleared, Opportunity never woke up. At the time, scientists understood the mechanics. Dust blocks sunlight. No sunlight, no power. Simple. But that storm also did something else. Something quieter. Something that didn't make headlines. It changed the atmosphere. For years, NASA's MAVEN orbiter, the Mars Atmosphere and Volatile Evolution mission, has been watching the Martian atmosphere like a sentinel. It measures gas composition, temperature layers, solar-wind interactions, everything that makes Mars' thin veil of air tick. And after that 2018 storm, MAVEN saw anomalies. The atmosphere didn't just get dustier, it got energized. Chemical reactions spiked, temperature gradients twisted in unexpected ways. Layers of the atmosphere that should have remained stable began to churn. Dr. Paul Withers, a planetary scientist at Boston University, described it in a 2022 paper as an atmospheric engine we didn't know existed. The dust wasn't just blocking light, it was powering something. Here's what we've learned. Martian dust particles are incredibly small, roughly 1/1000th the width of a human hair. They're made mostly of iron oxide, the same compound that gives Mars its red color, and Earth's rust its name. But on Mars, these particles do more than sit quietly. When sunlight hits them, they absorb energy. Not a little, a lot. Enough to heat the surrounding air by tens of degrees. This creates pockets of warmth in an otherwise freezing atmosphere. And when warm air meets cold air, you get motion, convection, circulation. In short, the dust doesn't just ride the wind, it creates the wind. But here's where it gets strange. According to new data from MAVEN and the European Space Agency's Trace Gas Orbiter, these temperature shifts don't behave predictably. The models we've used for decades, models based on Earth's atmosphere adjusted for Mars' thinner air, keep failing. The dust storms create feedback loops we didn't anticipate. Feedback loops are dangerous in any system. They're what turn a small spark into a wildfire, a gentle breeze into a hurricane. On Mars, they might turn a local dust devil into a planet-eating storm. And we're only just beginning to understand why. Dr. Lydia Hernandez, an atmospheric chemist at NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center, has spent the last 3 years analyzing MAVEN's data. In an internal research presentation obtained earlier this year, she described the complexity this way. We expected Mars to be a simpler version of the Earth, thinner atmosphere, weaker weather, slower cycles. What we're finding is the opposite. Mars is reactive. The dust doesn't dampen atmospheric activity, it amplifies it. Every storm leaves a signature, a chemical fingerprint, that lingers for weeks. And those fingerprints, they're different every time. Different every time. Think about that. On Earth, we can predict hurricanes days in advance. We understand jet streams, ocean currents, pressure systems. Our models aren't perfect, but they're reliable. On Mars, each storm seems to rewrite its own rules. Part of the problem is chemistry. Mars' atmosphere is 95% carbon dioxide. On Earth, CO2 is a trace gas, vital, but not dominant. On Mars, it's the entire game. And when dust heats that CO2, strange things happen. Dr. Michael Mishna, a research scientist at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory, explained it in a recent interview. Carbon dioxide has what we call a high radiative efficiency. It absorbs and re-emits infrared energy very effectively. On Mars, when dust heats a pocket of CO2, that heat doesn't just dissipate, it radiates. It spreads horizontally and vertically in ways our models struggle to predict. You get these cascading thermal waves, almost like atmospheric echoes, that can trigger new dust lifting events hundreds of miles away. Atmospheric echoes. Imagine dropping a stone into a still pond. The ripples spread outward, predictable and symmetrical. Now imagine the ripples doubling back, intersecting, amplifying each other, creating new waves from nothing. That's what's happening on Mars. But there's more. In 2021, the trace gas orbiter detected something unexpected during a regional dust storm in Mars' southern hemisphere. Water vapor. Not a lot. Mars is a desert world after all, but far more than should have been present at that altitude. Normally, water on Mars stays low. It freezes out of the atmosphere quickly, forming ice crystals or settling as frost. The upper atmosphere is a dry, radiation-scorched wasteland. But during the storm, water vapor was found nearly 50 miles above the surface. Dr. Anne Karine Vandel, a planetary scientist with the Royal Belgian Institute for Space Aeronomy and lead investigator for the orbiter's atmospheric suite, called it a transport mechanism we didn't anticipate. The dust wasn't just heating the air. It was lifting water into regions where it could be broken apart by ultraviolet radiation, split into hydrogen and oxygen, lost to space forever. Mars is losing its water, and the dust storms are helping it happen. Let's zoom out for a moment. Picture Mars as it truly is. Not the red dot in our night sky, but a world. A sphere of rock and ice and wind, spinning alone in the cold. 4 billion years ago, Mars might have looked very different. Liquid water pooled in vast basins. Rivers carved channels through ancient highlands. The atmosphere was thicker, warmer, protected by a magnetic field that has since died. But that Mars is gone. What remains is a planet in slow motion collapse. Its magnetic field is a ghost. Its atmosphere leaks into space. Its water hides beneath the surface or clings as ice at the poles. And yet it still breathes. Every Martian year, roughly 2 Earth years, the planet experiences what scientists call dust storm season. It happens during southern summer, when Mars is closest to the sun. The added solar energy stirs the air. Dust begins to rise. Sometimes these storms stay local. A few hundred miles across, they churn for a week or two, then fade. Other times, they grow, and grow, and grow, until the entire planet is shrouded. The 2018 storm covered an area larger than North America within days. Within weeks, it had encircled the globe. Winds reached 60 miles per hour, not hurricane strength by Earth standards, but enough to lift billions of tons of fine dust into the sky. From orbit, Mars became featureless, a smooth ochre sphere. Now imagine you're there. You're standing inside Jezero Crater, where the Perseverance rover now roams. The storm is approaching from the west. You can see it on the horizon, a curtain of russet haze blotting out the sun. The wind picks up. Not violently, Mars' thin air can't produce the crushing gusts of an Earth hurricane, but persistently, steadily, dust begins to swirl at your feet, then at your waist, then all around you. Within minutes, visibility drops to zero. The temperature plummets, not because the sun has set, but because sunlight can no longer reach you. You're standing on the surface of a planet, in the middle of the day, and it's twilight. Your suit's filters are clogging. The static electricity generated by swirling dust is interfering with your electronics. Your visor is coated in a film you can't wipe away. And the storm, this wall of airborne powder, could last for months. This is the reality future astronauts will face. And according to NASA's latest models, it's more unpredictable than we ever imagined. Humanity has always been drawn to Mars. Of all the worlds in our solar system, it's the one that feels almost possible. Close enough to reach. Familiar enough to imagine. We've sent rovers, landers, orbiters. We've mapped its surface in astonishing detail. We've found ancient riverbeds, detected organic molecules, confirmed the presence of liquid water beneath its icy crust. Mars is not alive, but it was, or it could be. And that's why we want to go. NASA's Artemis program aims to return humans to the moon by the mid-2020s. But the moon is a stepping stone. The real goal, the dream that has captivated engineers, scientists, and storytellers for generations, is Mars. Boots on red soil, a flag planted in rust, a second home. But survival on Mars will not be simple. The radiation alone is brutal. Without a magnetic field, cosmic rays and solar particles bombard the surface constantly. Prolonged exposure, average temperatures hover around minus 80 degrees Fahrenheit. At the poles, it drops to minus 200. Water exists, but it's locked in ice or buried underground. Extracting it will require energy, infrastructure, time. And then there's the dust. We've known for years that Martian dust is a problem. It clogs machinery, coats solar panels, reduces visibility. It's electrostatically charged, meaning it sticks to everything, suits, equipment, habitat seals. But these new findings suggest the danger runs deeper. If dust storms can alter atmospheric chemistry, if they can transport water vapor to altitudes where it's lost forever, then they're not just a weather hazard. They're an environmental variable. Dr. Jennifer Feldman, a planetary scientist at NASA Ames Research Center, put it bluntly in a 2023 mission briefing. We can't engineer around something we don't understand. If every dust storm behaves differently, if feedback loops create unpredictable thermal and chemical changes, then our life support systems, our HAB designs, our EVA protocols, all of it needs to be rethought. Rethought, not refined, not adjusted. Rethought. Consider the challenge. A human crew on Mars will rely on solar power, at least initially. Nuclear generators are an option, but they're heavy, complex, and politically contentious. Solar panels work on Mars. We've proven that, but only when the sun is visible. During a global dust storm, sunlight can drop by 99%. That's not hyperbole. That's data from Opportunity's final days. Batteries can store energy, but not indefinitely. A storm that lasts 3 months would require either massive energy reserves, impractical to transport from Earth, or alternative power sources that haven't been fully tested in Martian conditions. And energy is just one variable. What about food production? Most proposed Mars habitats include greenhouses, sealed environments where plants grow under artificial light, recycling CO2 into oxygen. But plants need light. If a storm cuts power and your LEDs go dark, your crops die. Your oxygen production drops. Your crew's survival window shrinks. Then there's mobility. Rovers can navigate dust storms, as we've seen. But humans in suits? That's different. Visibility, near zero. Navigation systems confused by static interference. Risk of getting lost mere meters from your habitat. One wrong step, one suit breach. That's all it takes. But here's the thing about challenges. They force us to innovate. NASA, ESA, and private space agencies are already adapting. Engineers are designing dust-resistant seals, self-cleaning solar panels, and advanced filtration systems. Atmospheric scientists are feeding the new MAVEN data into updated climate models, trying to predict storm behavior with greater accuracy. Mission planners are considering hybrid power systems, solar and nuclear combined, to ensure redundancy. Psychologists are studying isolation and stress, preparing crews for months-long confinements inside sealed HABs. Astrobiologists are even asking whether the dust itself could be useful, perhaps as raw material for construction, or as a radiation shield when piled atop habitats. We are learning. But the lesson here is humility. Mars is not a blank canvas. It's not a dead rock waiting passively for us to arrive. It's a world. Dynamic. Reactive. Alien. And if we're going to live there, even temporarily, we need to respect that. There's a bigger question lurking beneath all of this. Why does Mars matter? Why risk so much to reach a frozen desert where the air is poison and the ground is toxic? Some say it's about survival, a backup plan for humanity in case Earth becomes uninhabitable. Others say it's about curiosity, the same drive that sent our ancestors across oceans and over mountains. Still others say it's about meaning, about proving that we are more than one pale blue dot, that we can become a multiplanetary species. All of these answers are true, but there's something deeper. Mars teaches us that the universe doesn't owe us anything. Earth is a miracle, a world where water flows, where oxygen fills the air, where a magnetic field shields us from radiation, where life has flourished for billions of years. We were born into paradise, cosmically speaking, and we take it for granted. Mars, harsh, hostile, unforgiving, reminds us what the universe really looks like. It shows us what happens when a planet loses its magnetic field, when its atmosphere bleeds into space, when water vanishes and dust takes over. Mars is a warning, but it's also an opportunity. If we can learn to live there, if we can understand its storms, its chemistry, its dangers, then we prove something profound, that intelligence matters, that adaptability matters, that cooperation, ingenuity, and courage can overcome even the coldest, most alien environments. We prove that life, conscious, curious life, doesn't have to be confined to one world, and in doing so, we change what it means to be human. These dust storms, complex and chaotic as they are part of that journey. Every new data point from MAVEN, every unexpected chemical signature, every atmospheric anomaly, they're not setbacks. They're chapters in a story we're still writing, the story of us and Mars. So where does this leave us? NASA hasn't canceled its Mars plans. If anything, the agency is doubling down. The Artemis program will test technologies on the moon that will later be used on Mars. Perseverance continues to collect samples that a future mission will retrieve and bring home. International partnerships are forming. Private companies are building rockets powerful enough to reach the red planet. We are going. But we're going with our eyes open. These new findings about Martian dust storms are a gift, not a curse. They're a reminder that exploration is not about conquering nature, it's about understanding it. We don't get to dictate terms to Mars. We get to listen, to observe, to adapt. And maybe if we're careful and clever and humble enough, we get to stay. Out here, 140 million miles from home, a world spins beneath a butterscotch sky. Dust rises and falls in patterns we're only beginning to decode. The wind whispers across ancient craters and dry riverbeds, carrying secrets in every grain. And somewhere, years from now, maybe decades, a human being will stand on that surface for the first time. They'll look up at a sky turned amber by suspended dust. They'll feel the thin wind against their suit, and they'll know, in that moment, that they are standing on the edge of two worlds. One behind them, green and blue and alive, a distant star in the Martian sky. One beneath their feet, red and wild and strange, waiting to be understood. The universe doesn't give us easy answers, but it gives us questions worth asking, and sometimes that's enough. If discoveries like this fascinate you, subscribe. The universe is just getting started.